All right. Good morning, everybody.
God bless all of you. A lot going on this morning. We're kind of dragging or something, aren't we?
It's a little busy.
A little slow this morning.
Slow? You mean on the response or?
No, on the getting going there.
Well, it's 11:05. That's about normal.
Or six.
Six, seven,
or six,
whatever.
Yeah, somewhere
it's
in there.
It's normal for us.
It's close, yeah.
I know, boy, I tell you.
So how are you doing?
A lot of activities going on.
I know.
I did hear a story the other day.
Yeah.
And I guess this car, this fella, he was, his whole car full of, he had about, I don't know, 15 penguins in there. And
yeah.
Police stopped him.
Said, penguins.
Yeah, penguins. Yeah. He said, man, get them to the zoo. Take them to the zoo. And so, yes, sir. Next day, he got them again, and the policeman stops. He said, I thought I told you to take them penguins to the zoo. He said, I did. I'm taking them to the movies today.
Oh, boy. Woo!
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Okay. Yeah, well, all right. It's a holiday, so, you know.
Yeah, everybody grilling and all that barbecue and all that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just thinking. You might be a redneck. You know, you've heard those. I said, you might be a redneck if you're out there getting ready to barbecue some spam.
Oh, yeah. You might be a redneck.
What is spam, anyway?
What's,
is that pork? What is? I don't know what it is.
It's a collection of things, I believe.
I guess. Spam.
It might be leftovers.
How many kids? Have y'all ever had spam?
Yeah.
See, none of them raise their hand. Hey, well, older guys. Yeah, older folks. Yeah, I don't see these young kids.
No, they've been advertising it lately on TV. Don't,
yeah, I know it.
Yeah?
Don't, or if they still have that little key. Remember that little key you put in there and you sort of twist it around the top?
Don't knock it till you fried it.
That's right.
Fried it. That's what they say on TV now.
So for us younger people, what's unwanted email?
Oh.
Oh, nice.
All right. That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
That's pretty. Even Jim came through with one there. Yeah.
That's pretty good, Jim.
Spam.
Stick to playing that trumpet.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll do the jokes. You play music.
That was a good one. That was a good one, Jim. All right.
All right.
All right. Let's
that
go.
It?
Let's go.
All right. We've got some new people here today, or visitors, and let's see how many new people we have today. If this is your first time, now, is it Emery? Emberly. Emberly is over here. Look at Emberly.
All right. Yeah.
Brand new
the little
to
one.
Emberly. Amen.
All right.
Granddaughter.
New
All
one,
right. Brand new. Brand new Nancy back here is Jennifer's mom, Nancy. Huh?
Burnett.
Nancy Burnett.
All right.
Great to have you here today, Nancy. God bless you. Amen. Anyone else who is brand new, you have not been here before?
Anyone?
All right. So Jody and Melanie back there. It's good to see them.
Absolutely.
Back from Florida. Up to visit a little bit. And others. Well, we got Judy and Dale's family here.
Yeah.
We have, of course, Carolyn, we see every once in a while. But Bob and Tom... Not the radio, Bob and Tom. Not. Bob and Tom are here today, too. It's good to see you all today. God bless you all. Bob's looking sharp there with his haircut and goatee.
It's looking good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Reminds me of somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Anyone else? I don't want to miss people. Anybody else who's brand new or hasn't been here in a while? Just coming back 5 years ago. Yeah. All right.
Good to see you.
All right. Amen. What about birthdays? Let's get some birthdays rolling here.
Judy.
Judy has a birthday. Carolyn. Happy birthday, Carolyn.
All right.
Judy. Who else?
Who up?
Any other birthdays?
Val. Val, you got your birthday. All right.
Val.
Up here.
Happy birthday, Val. You're trying to sneak one in there on us.
All right.
And anyone else? Oh, Nancy had a birthday. God bless you. Right there, right. Brother Ricky. Happy birthday. Anyone else?
Did you get Carolyn back in the back?
Did you get Carolyn? Yeah. Carolyn. Bye. All right. How about anniversaries? Any anniversaries? All right.
Are we good?
Dave, I guess we're good to go. Oh.
Oh, William.
Willie.
And Marlene.
And Marlene. Happy anniversary. Marlene, you weren't going to say anything, huh? You were going to see what he did, weren't you? See if he's proud. How many? How many? 53. Wow. Amen.
That's big.
That's great. God bless y'all.
Congrats. All right.
Any others?
Are we ready?
Huh? What? Oh. All right.
You forgot something. She's just not going to tell you till afterwards.
I know.
Yeah, you'll get in trouble. All right. Are we ready? Let us stand. So we all sing, God bless America. God bless America.
Father, thank you so much for your goodness, for your blessings, for all you do for us. And Father, we thank you especially today for our nation and for the freedoms and liberties that we have. And we thank you for those who gave their lives to keep us free. And Father, we're on this Memorial Day weekend. I pray that we'd never forget all those who paid the ultimate price. And Father, we're also thankful for all those who served and survived. And we're thankful for those who are serving today to keep us free. And I pray, Father, that we as the church would pray, would turn from our own wicked ways, and would do all that we can to help America. We need help. And Father, we ask your blessings upon us. May we continue to always support Israel. And may we be godly. And may the churches, may we preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, please bless us today as we worship. I pray that you'd bless every person. You'd meet every need. And Lord, help us to rejoice that we were here today. And Father, I just ask that you'd also encourage us and embolden us that we'll stand strong, that we'll be salt and light, and that we'll be genuine ambassadors for the Lord Jesus. Thank you so much, Father, for all your goodness, all your grace. And above all, for the wonderful, incredible, unspeakable gift of Jesus. And we pray in his name, amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. Let's sing that chorus to Blessed Assurance. Let's sing the chorus. John, come and sing a verse. This is my song. This is my
so happy and so blessed. Now I'm watching and I'm waiting. I'm looking above. I am filled with His goodness, and I'm lost in His love. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story.
Let me give you a couple of announcements here, or a few announcements. First of all, from Jalen, she has a note to thank you, church family, for your generous donations to the food drive, and she appreciates that very much, as do I. Thank you. Today, our special offering, and not this offering, our regular offering, but the special ones you leave, is for WLJC. Our ministry there, it's very expensive to be on there every week. Now, the quartet will be there when? David, where'd you go?
Thursday night.
Quartet will be there this Thursday. And so you might want to tune in there. Now, there's no preaching, so I know it's not as good as you'd really find, but they'll be singing. All right, that's Thursday night, and please help us with that, the support. Tonight is our church picnic, first church picnic of the year. At this moment, we're going to be at the camp. For now, we're going to be at the camp, and we'll have games, and we'll have food, and we'll have fellowship. If things change, we'll try to get the word out.
One call.
Second option will be the gym. I haven't planned on a third option yet, but anyway. So, Johnny, wherever you are, we may need you, but I pray that we'll be able to be at the camp at 6. And then Saturday, this coming Saturday, is our summer kickoff. And we'll have all those blow-up things that kids like, popcorn, cotton candy, all those things. Now, we need lots of volunteers for that. So that's 1 to 4 on this coming Saturday, June 1st, okay? And VBS starts June 3rd, so that's a week from tomorrow. We need help still, so if you'd like to volunteer for VBS, a great ministry, then see John, please. And then I don't have it on the bulletin, but of course we'll have prayer breakfast. A prayer brunch coming up on June the 8th. We are going to have a baptism next Sunday morning. Normally it's always Sunday evening, but Wesley is going to be baptized and some of the Fist folks couldn't be here at night, so we're going to do that next Sunday morning. If you've accepted Christ as your Savior, have not been baptized, then next Sunday morning let's get that taken care of, okay? All right, and then we got weddings coming up, weddings everywhere. The 8th is Luke and Betty, 15th, John and Tammy. And so we have lots going on. All right, I think I've got everything. Everybody good?
All right, just before the message, we're going to have the Markley sing a song. with Steph, all right?
Please turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Now at the end of the service, we have something special, and I'll get to that when it's time. But don't run out on me. All right, don't give up on me. All right, Ephesians chapter 4. Megan, good to have you with us today. God bless you and your family. In verse 17, this I say therefore and testify in the Lord. Did I say four? Did I say chapter four? Chapter four, verse 17. This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart, who, being past feeling, have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness with greediness. Now, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth. We thank you for your living, powerful words that you give to us. And I pray, Father, as we study together, that every word spoken would be yours and not mine, and that your will is done in our lives. May we be doers of the word, not just hearers. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this morning, from this passage in Ephesians, Paul, as you know, over the last a couple of Sunday nights, has told us what we are to do as Christians, that we are to be equipped, we're to present ourselves to the pastor teacher, to the Holy Spirit, to the Word of God, to be equipped to do the work of the ministry, which is to build up the church. We're to build up the church numerically. We're to build up the church spiritually. That's what we're to do. And we're to grow up in Christ. And those who are still babes in Christ, he says to grow up, especially those who've been saved a long time, and you're still not mature in the faith. He says, be no more children, but we're to have sound, unwavering faith, not allow ourselves to be carried about by all kinds of doctrine, of false doctrine, and things that we hear and see, and they sound right, and they tickle our ears. He says, that shouldn't be a mature Christian, the only sound, unwavering doctrine. And then that we should speak the truth in love, working together in unity to build up the church. But then he goes into the unbelievers, the characteristics of the unsaved. And we know some of those characteristics. If you're unsaved, we know that you've rejected Christ. We know that you're lost. We know that you're dead in trespasses and sins. If we described you as someone who has not accepted Christ as Savior, now you're not different than we are in the way in that we have all sinned. Everybody has sinned and come short of the glory of God, and all of us was condemned because of our sin. But for believers, we say that that's what we were. But now we've been washed by His blood. Our sins are cleansed, and we've been saved, born again into the family of God. And so we are children of God, working for Him to make disciples, ambassadors for Christ. But if you're unsaved, the adjectives are lost, dead. You're already condemned. You're already dead in sins and trespasses and without hope. There's no hope for you if you continue rejecting the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there's other things that the Bible says about those who are unsaved. And let's look at those in our what the passage says for us. Let me get this turned on. And I think we're good to go. So here's some characteristics according to this scripture, in addition to the ones that I just gave you about that you are, wait a minute, you are lost, you are dead, and you're without hope. But here's some other things in addition to that. First of all, the unsaved lives in the futility of their minds. They live in the futility of their minds. Our passage says they walk not, that we're to not walk as the unsaved in the vanity. They walk in the vanity, and that means futility of their mind. And the word futility means emptiness. It means useless. That they're walking, they're trusting in, they're pursuing things that ultimately are useless, that ultimately are empty or vain. And so that's the word futility. In other words, their thinking is messed up. Those who are unsaved, their thinking, they're distracted so that their thinking is not right. Their mind is messed up. I don't mean in a mental way. They can be brilliant and their minds are still messed up because they're looking at the temporary over eternal. That's messed up. Because the temporary, it lasts only a few years. Our life is brief. The Bible says it's a vapor, and then it's gone. Years go by so quickly. Lives go by so quickly. And for us to put all of our attention on the temporary rather than eternal, that's messed up.
Amen.
Our minds aren't right. We're thinking toward our thinking is futile. It also says that it also indicates when we talk about this futility that they're thinking of themselves over God.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, in Romans 1 it says they're making themselves God rather than God. They have no thought about eternity. No thought about eternity. You know, one of the reasons that we must always be careful to preach the gospel at funeral services is because that's the only time when some people in their lives think at all about death and eternity. And they may go through their lives and their minds are totally upon today, what I'm pursuing, this temporary life, and they don't hear the gospel. They don't think about eternity. And so to let that go by would be a sin. To have people in the service, we must give them the gospel. And that's why we do it. And some people may say, well, don't really preach. Well, we have to. If there's unsaved people in the house, we must preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so they live in the futility of their thinking. Secondly, they're ignorant of the things of God. It says in our passage, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance of, that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. Again, I'm not talking about something that is mentally wrong with them, but they're ignorant of the blessings of the treasures of the Lord Jesus Christ compared to what they're pursuing now. In Hebrews chapter 11, Moses, remember he was the grandson because the daughter of Pharaoh had rescued him from the river. He was the grandson of Pharaoh. So he was looking at a life of wealth, of power, of the best of the best. But it says this about Moses. It says that he refused to keep or to he refused to live that lifestyle. It says choosing rather in Hebrews chapter 11, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Now listen, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. He had respect unto the recompense of the reward. And so his His thinking was right. But the unsaved live in the ignorance of not knowing the treasures we have in the Lord Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins, being born into God's family, eternal life. And we could go on and on and on, but the Bible says their understanding is darkened. Look in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and look at verse 4. It says, in whom the lost, it's referring to in verse 3, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them who believe not, the unsaved who believe not, blinded the minds of those who believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. They are ignorant of the things of God. Their understanding, their minds have been darkened or blinded by the god of this world, Satan, by the things of the world, by the pleasures of sin for a season. Secondly, in being ignorant of the things of God, they deny the truth. They deny the truth. There are people who deny the fact that Jesus is the only way of salvation. They deny the truth of that there is an eternal hell. They deny the truth that they're going there if they reject Christ as Savior. They believe a lie. Again, in Romans 1, it says that they believe a lie. They choose preference over truth. They choose the way they want things to be rather than the way things are in the truth. And not only their understanding darkened and that they deny the truth, but the hardness of their hearts. Again, in our text, it says, because of the blindness of their heart, the word there is the hardening of their hearts. They are futile and they're foolish, the unsaved. They're chasing after things that are just a vapor, and they're foolish because they believe a lie, and that they've been blinded and their hearts have been hardened. And then it goes on to say, they become callous. Look in verse 19. Who being past feeling, they become callous. You know what a callous is. All of our softball team. Jim, you didn't mention anything about practice today. You called it off for Memorial Day. All right. These softball players, if they're going to be any good at all, if you look at them, they'll have callus on their hands. If you look at their hands and it looks like dishpan hands, they're not going to be any good, right? They can't hit. If their hands look like mine, they can't hit, right? No comment. Okay. All right. Calluses. We develop calluses on our feet. We develop calluses on our hands because it shows that we're doing something. We're developing muscles. Well, in the negative way, they have become callous to the work of the Holy Spirit. They've become callous to conviction. They've become callous to truth. And so they are past, it says they're past feeling. You've seen people like that, haven't you? They're past feel. They don't even have conviction. They have no concern for the Lord Jesus. They have no concern for church. They don't even want to hear anything. And it does not bother them. They're past feeling. They have no regard for God. Let me tell you, if there's someone here today unsaved, putting off, when you're convicted and you put that off, that's dangerous. Every time you walk away from the conviction of the Holy Spirit, every time you walk away from the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, Every time you walk away from an opportunity to be saved, that is dangerous. So dangerous. Of course, you never know when you get another opportunity. But the more you reject Him and reject Him and reject Him, the harder you get. That's why, listen, that's why parents and youth workers, it's why it's so important to reach our youth while they're young. Parents, so important to reach your youth while they're young, while their hearts are tender, and while they believe. And Jesus said, unless we believe, unless we have the faith of a child, as people get older and older and older and older, the probabilities of them being saved becomes almost minuscule. Because as they've grown older and rejected Christ and rejected Christ and rejected Christ, their heart gets harder and harder and more callous. And it's hard to see them saved. Not impossible, but you just don't see it often from an elderly person being saved. And so we need to work at when they're young people and work as hard as we can, as soon as we can. And then the fourth thing is they're depraved. Now I know that all of us are depraved in the sense that we're born sinners. I mean, we are sinners by, as you know the expression, we're sinners by birth and we're sinners by practice. And so the Bible says there's none good, no, not one. And so we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We know that we think some things are just beyond what people will do, but then we know there's nothing beyond what people will do. All the way back in Noah's day when it says their mind was on evil continually and until today, and the things that we see now, we're not even fazed by them now, unfortunately. The things that years ago, not even many years ago, we would never talk about. We sure never see it, and we sure never think that it would be accepted, and yet all kinds of things that we'd never imagined are going on. We're depraved. But those who reject Christ over and over and over, they are even more depraved. We'll just say they're depraved. It says their past feeling in verse 9, and have given themselves over unto lasciviousness. Some of you might have licentiousness. But anyway, this simply means this: the absence of moral restraint. It is the absence of any concern about right and wrong, but whatever they want to do. That's what happens. They're so depraved. They have the absence of moral restraint. They have unbridled self-indulgence. Unbridled self-indulgence, meaning they will do anything and it doesn't bother them at all. Their sinfulness does not convict them. They despise the authority of Christ. You know, that's one of the things in our society that drives people away from us. They hate the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right. They hate authority. They don't want someone telling them, you're a sinner. They don't want someone setting a standard of what you ought to do and ought not to do. They don't want the truth of our sinfulness, of our condemnation, of what we must do to be saved. They do not want authority over their lives. And then it says in Romans 1:28, they have given themselves over to a reprobate mind. And that reprobate mind means a godless, corrupt mind. And so when you think of these things, and let me just summarize it with this, those words that I gave you, lost, dead, no hope. I mean, what an awful shape to be in. But the Bible says they live in the futility of their mind, that their thinking is messed up. When you consider temporal over eternal, that's messed up thinking. When you think you are God rather than God, that's messed up. When you never have any thought about eternity, that's messed up. That you're ignorant, the unsaved, you're ignorant of the things of God. Again, don't be insulted by the fact I said ignorant. That just means you don't know. That means you don't understand, because your understanding is darkened. You've been blinded. You deny the truth. Your heart is hard. You've become callous, even harder. You're past feeling conviction. And you're depraved. Lost, dead, no hope. That's where you are without Christ. But, because the Lord Jesus died for your sins, because He took all of your sins, all your rejection, all the things you've done, all the things you've said, all the things you've been, He took all those sins upon Himself, and He died in our place for our sins. He took everything. He drank the cup of all the sins of all time, of every person. He drank the cup. He bore our sins. The Bible said He became our sins. He became sin and died on the cross, a substitute for us. And even though you've rejected Him, maybe time and time and time again, He loves you still. And He wants to forgive you, and He wants to save you. If you're here today without the Lord Jesus Christ, this is the time, this is the place for you to come to Jesus, repent of your sins, and ask Him come into your life, forgive you, and save you. Give your life to Him. And Christians, there's sometimes these things strike us hard, and you may have made a profession at some time, and yet if these things fit you, the Bible says, make your calling and election sure. Make sure. It'd be rather to come down and make sure than to wonder about it for the rest of your life and be convicted that there's something you need to do, something you don't have, something that's not right. And so the Lord speaks to your heart this morning, you do right. You make the right decision. You do the right thing. Let me ask you to do this before I pray. Would you bow your heads, please? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Please don't look around. Let me ask you this. Is there anyone who'd be willing to say, I'm not saved? I'm not going to call your name. I'm not going to come back to where you are. I'm not going to embarrass you. I just want you, if you'd raise your hand, that I'm going to pray for you. That's all I'm asking. Is there anyone here that's not saved? You just raise your hand and let me see it. And I'll do this. I'll say, God bless you. And then you can put it right back down. Is anyone that doesn't know Christ as Savior? All right, let me ask you this. There is a Christian, any Christian, you are struggling in your life. There's something you struggle with basically every day. And you feel confident you're saved, but you have this struggle going on. And you say, would you pray for me this morning? Again, you just raise your hand. I am not going to embarrass you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless you. Are there any others? Any others? Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? There's a constant struggle goes on in your life every day. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Father, thank you so much for your word and the truth of it, even when it hurts, even when it's hard. You give us the truth because you love us. And Lord, I pray that now during this invitation that people will respond to your word, to the Holy Spirit's conviction. And Lord, we just pray that you meet every need of every person. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Now, I'm going to ask you to stand, please, quietly, reverently. Heads bowed. Listen, here's what I'd like for you to do. Here's what the Holy Spirit would like for you to do. Let me rephrase that. If you're not saved, maybe you didn't raise your hand. I didn't see any hands of anybody saying they're unsaved. But you would come. You're not saved, but you would come. Deacons, you come. You would come and say, I want to be saved. I didn't come. I didn't raise my hand. But I'm coming now to be saved. You come on. Christians, you raised your hand. There's a struggle going on in your life. Now, again, I'm not gonna identify you raising your hand, but you may want to come and pray. Nobody's gonna ask you anything. We're not gonna pry into your life. You just come to the altar and pray. If you want someone to pray with you, we have deacons here at the front. Or you can get somebody along the way, up the aisle. You get them. Would you come? As the Lord speaks to your heart, to be saved, to bring a struggle to the Lord, and He can give you rest. Come right now. Just step out. You come.
Pass me now, O gentle Savior.
People are coming. You come. You come. Have a need in your life, you have a struggle in your life, you come. You need to be saved, you come.
Yeah.